Friends, in the previous clip, video clip, we have discussed about stress strain, Hooke's law, Young's modulus, Poisson's ratio, etc., etc. Now, I am continuing the same thing. We have come up to the definition of Young's modulus. Apart from Young's modulus, we also have what we call modulus of rigidity. Modulus of rigidity. Or it is also called as the shear modulus, and one more is the bulk modulus. These are the three moduli that are there in a, for a material. We have to know this. This modulus of rigidity or shear modulus is denoted by C or G. It is defined as a ratio of shear stress to shear strain. Ratio of shear stress to shear strain within elastic limit. Its unit is Newton per mm square. As Young's modulus or modulus of elasticity, it is, you know, modulus of elasticity is just stress by strain, direct stress by strain. Here it is shear stress by shear strain. Now, this definition they will ask. Now, this is important, that it is within elastic limit. The next one is the bulk modulus. Bulk modulus, its symbol is, generally we use the symbol K for this. This K is defined as ratio of direct stress to volumetric strain, again within elastic limit. The condition is the material should be within elastic limit. I have already told you what is the meaning of elastic limit. Unit of this is also Newton per mm square, because this doesn't have unit, this is having Newton per mm square. So, the unit is Newton per mm square. So, there are totally three moduli. Moduli is the plural of modulus. The three moduli of a material are E, the three moduli are E, C and K. E is modulus of elasticity or Young's modulus. C is rigidity modulus. And K is bulk modulus. Now, these three are connected by these formulae. How? Number one, E is equal to 2C into 1 plus 1 by M. See, this relationship connects Young's modulus, rigidity modulus and Poisson's ratio. So, if out of these three, if we know any two, then the third one can be found out. The second relationship is E is equal to 3K into 1 minus 2 times 1 by M. That is, this relationship again connects Young's modulus or modulus of elasticity, bulk modulus and the Poisson's ratio. Out of these three, if we know any two, then the third one can be found out. The third relationship is E is equal to 9KC divided by 3K plus C. Now, this relationship connects Young's modulus, bulk modulus and modulus of rigidity. Out of these three, if we know any two, the third one can be found out. So, these relationships we must remember. You must remember these relationships. They can ask a problem on this also. Then, your syllabus says, mentions the study of temperature or thermal stress also. So, I will just touch that. Temperature stress, or it is also called as thermal stress. See, suppose I have a metallic rod. Metallic rod, let us say, its length is L1, millimeter or centimeter or meter, whatever it is, at a particular temperature T1 degree centigrade. Now, if this temperature changes means it may either increase or decrease. If the temperature increases, if T2 is more than T1, then it should expand. If it is cooled, that is T2 is less than T1, then it should contract, its length should decrease. Right. If this change in length, it wants some change in length, if that is not allowed, then this will be subjected to a stress. That stress is known as temperature stress or thermal stress. It is called as temperature or thermal stress because it is happening in the material due to change in temperature. Now, here, first what we have to do is we have to find out how much change it wants. How much change it wants depends upon three things: alpha, L1 into delta T. These three, if you multiply these three, then you will get delta L. That is how much this rod wants to increase or decrease in length. Here, alpha means linear temperature coefficient of the material, that is the material of this rod, per degree centigrade. L1 is the initial length in mm, usually it will be in mm. Delta T means change in temperature, that is it may be T1 minus T2 or it may be either T1 minus T2 or T2 minus T1, depending upon which is bigger. So that's why it is called as change in temperature. This will give you the increase or decrease in length it wants. Now, if we don't allow it fully, there will be no stress, no strain, nothing will be there. If we do not allow it either fully or partially, either fully or partly, then what happens is there will be strain. Now, the strain in the material, that is linear strain, whenever I say strain, it is linear strain, this will be equal to delta L minus X divided by L1. That is, this is change in length it wants minus what we allow. Suppose this is 5 mm, if I allow 1 mm, then what I am not allowing is 4 mm. If you don't allow anything, then this X will be 0, then the whole length divided by L1 will give you the strain. Then stress in the material will be E into E. You know stress is, E is stress by strain, so stress will be E into E. If you know E, that is Young's modulus, and if you know the strain, you can get the stress. This stress which is developed in the material is known as the temperature stress. Its nature will be either tensile or compressive. We are heating it, it wants to expand, we don't allow it to expand, then it is compressive. If we are cooling it, it wants to contract, we are not allowing that contraction, then it will be the tensile stress which is developed. So the nature of thermal stress or temperature stress will be either tensile or compression, depending upon whether we are heating it or cooling it. Then the load that is acting, the load to which it is subjected, axial load to which it is subjected, will be stress into area of cross section. This will give you the load, axial load to which it is subjected. So these are the formulae that will come in temperature stress. Now after this, we will work out a few numericals on this chapter called simple stress and strain. Let us take up a few questions, problems, numericals from the question bank issued by the board. We will take up that and solve some problems so that you will understand how to do it. Now, I have taken the 11th problem. It reads like this, problem number 11. a load of 5 kilonewton, a load of 5 kilonewton is to be raised or lifted with the help of a wire, steel wire. Find the diameter of the wire. Find the diameter of the wire. If the allowable stress in the material is not to exceed 100 newton per mm square, or it is given as 100 MPa, megapascals. Now 100 megapascal is nothing but 100 newton per mm square only. Now this load should be converted into newton. This is 5000 newton. We have to find the diameter. He has given these two. Now you know stress is equal to load by area, P by A. Here we know the load, this is known to us, and the stress, allowable stress, is known to us. So if we know these two, you can find out A. A will be equal to P by F. This F will come here, A will go there. So P is 5000 and this is 100. So this is 50 mm square. This is in newton, this is in newton per mm square. So A will be 50 mm square, square mm. Now, because he has asked the diameter, that means the wire is circular in section. So area of cross section will be pi d square by 4. You know, area of a circle is pi d square by 4. We know the area. Now, if you substitute the area, you will get the diameter. So 4a divided by pi is equal to d square. Therefore, d will be equal to square root of 4a by pi. That is square root of 4 into 50 divided by pi. 4 into 50 divided by pi. If you calculate it here, 4 multiplied by 50 divided by pi will give me this much. Square root of that, square root of answer will give me 7.97 something mm. We can take it as say 8 mm. We'll take it as 8 mm. This is the answer. This is how it should be solved. Stress is given. So we'll get first area, then area. If you know the area, you can get the diameter. Diameter can be got. I hope you have understood this. This is how it should be done. It's a very simple problem on simple stress and strain. I cannot do all the problems. I have selected a few problems from the question bank. I am doing them. In case you have any problem, any difficulty, you can always contact me over phone and ask me to clarify. I shall be very happy to clarify. Now, the second problem is problem number 13. A punch with a diameter 20 mm. A punch with a diameter 20 mm is used to punch hole in aluminium plate of thickness 4 mm. Thickness 4 mm. If the ultimate shear stress of the aluminium is 275, ultimate shear stress of it is 275 newton per mm square or megapascal. Megapascal means newton per mm square only. What force P is required to punch the hole? So here I'll show you a sketch, a rough sketch. This is an aluminium plate. This is the aluminium plate. Its thickness is 4 mm given. Now, this is aluminium plate. In this, we want to punch a hole. This is the punch. Now, if we press this against this, this is going to cut a hole in this. It should cut a hole. This is how that material will come out. This is T and this is dia of the hole that we are going to make. This is the dia of the punch. Dia of the punch, we are punching the hole like that. You know, like paper punch, you know. Now, what is the force required? Now, here, you know, stress is load by area. So, here, because it should cut it, we have to take ultimate shear stress of the material, that is aluminium, into A will give us P. If you cross multiply, F into A gives me P. P is equal to Fs into Fs ultimate, ultimate shear stress, because it has to break. You have to take that into A, area to be sheared. Now, area will be equal to pi dt. That is, pi d will give you the circumference into thickness of that this thing. That will give you the area. So, this will be 275 into pi into 20 into 4. So many Newton. This works out to how much? 275 into pi into pi into 20 into 4 equals 63115 point something, so in Newton. Or if I divide it by 1000, it will be 63.115 kilo Newton. This will be the answer. 63, this is P. This is the force required to punch the hole, or the load required to punch the hole in that plate. So this is how it should be done. So here, in the earlier problem, P and F were given, we found out A. Here, A and F are given, we have to find out, we are asked to find the value of P. So like this, we get simple problems on this, which have to be solved like this. Next, I will take up one more problem, that is the 14th problem, problem number 14. I have taken little different problems. The following data pertains to a tensile test conducted in a laboratory. Diameter of the specimen D is 15 mm. Length of the specimen, we will call this as D1. L1, 200 mm. Then extension under a load of 10 kN. When the load was 10 kN, the extension absorbed, delta L, was absorbed to be 0.035 mm. Then load at yield point P, at yield point, is 110 kN. Then maximum load P max, or ultimate load, is 190 kN. Then finally the specimen broke. The length after fracture, after failure, that is, I'll call it as final length of the specimen, is 255 mm. First initial length is 200. Final length is this thing. Final dia at the neck is 12.25 mm. He is asking us to find out Young's modulus, or modulus of elasticity, yield stress, maximum or ultimate stress, and percentage elongation, percentage reduction in area, percentage reduction in area. These are the things he is asking us to find out. We are asked to find out. Now, to understand it better, what I will do is, I will draw a stress strain diagram Already I have drawn it once in the previous clip. Once again, to understand this problem, I will draw the stress strain diagram. Stress strain diagram is nothing but load elongation graph, load versus elongation. This is called the stress strain diagram because stress is load proportional to load and strain is proportional to elongation. So that graph I told you will come like this it will come. Now, when the load is 10 kilonewton somewhere here, the extension, the increase in length was 0.035. So this is within elastic limit, or this is the yield point. Stress at that point is called the yield point. Here the load is 110 kilonewton. This is the maximum stress. The load at that point is 190 kilonewton. So these values are given. We are asked to find the various things. This you will do in lab also, in mechanical testing lab also. We make you to do it. This such calculations we will do it here. Now first what I will do is I will find out the initial area of the specimen, that is pi d1 square by 4. Specimen means the piece we have taken for the test is called as specimen. That is a sample piece on which the test is conducted, and the result of that test will be applied to all the material of same composition. So this will be pi into 15 square divided by 4. That works out to, I think, 176.7 square mm. This is A1. Now, stress at this point within elastic limit is load by area A1, that is 10,000 Newton. It is given as 10 kilonewton divided by area is 176.7. This works out to 10,000 divided by 176.7. This works out to 56.6 Newton per mm square. This is in Newton, this is in square mm, so it will be Newton per square mm. This is the stress within elastic limit. We have not reached the elastic limit, that is the stress. The strain at that particular point is delta L by L1, change in length by original length. This is 0.035 divided by 200. This works out to 1.75 into 10 to the power of minus 4. No unit for that. It works out to that much strain. Now, Young's modulus is, you know, the ratio of stress to strain. Ratio of stress to strain. Stress divided by strain within elastic limit. So, it is 56.6 divided by 1.75 into 10 to the power of minus 4. This will give me 56.6 to 10 4 divided by 1.75 will give me 56.6 10 of 4 divided by 3234 28 point something Newton per mm square. This is Young's modulus or modulus of elasticity. Now this can be written as, if you press engineering, it will be 323 into 10 to the power of this thing, or it can be written as 0.32 into 10 to the power of 6 Newton per mm square. This is the value of Young's modulus. Next, he wants yield stress at this point. Stress at that point will be yield load divided by initial area of cross section. That is, Py is 110 into 1000 or 10 to the power of 3 to convert it into Newton, divided by area is 176.7 mm square. So that will give me 110 into 1000 into 1000 divided by 176.7. That gives me 622.5 Newton per mm square. This is the stress at this point. Now, the stress at that point, F max will be P max divided by A2, because by the time it has gone there, it has, its diameter has decreased considerably, its length has increased. We know the final diameter here, so we have to take the final area. So that will be 190 into 10 to the power of 3 divided by pi into d2 square, that is 12.25 square divided by 4, that 4 can be written here. So that will be first 190 followed by 3 zeros, 190 followed by 3 zeros into 4 divided by pi divided by 12.25 square will give me, no, I think I didn't square it, 190 followed by 1, 2, 3, 4 zeros into 4 divided by pi divided by 12.25 square will give me 1612 Newton per mm square. This is the ultimate or maximum stress in the body, induced in the body. So you got this, we got this, we got this. Next, percentage elongation. Percentage elongation will be, percentage elongation will be L2 minus L1, that is the total increase in length divided by original length into 100. L2 is 255, L1 is 200 divided by 200 into 100. That is total change in length divided by the original length into 100. Percentage elongation, this works out to, I think, 27.5%. 27.5% if you work out. Then the percentage reduction in area, percentage reduction in area will be A1 minus A2 divided by A1 into 100. A1 means area corresponding to this, that is 176.7. A2 means area corresponding to this, this is 117.8 divided by original area 176.7 into 100. This works out to 33.3%. So this is this is how this problem is to be done. This you will do in lab also, in the mechanical testing lab also, we will do those such type of problems.